All right, it's the top of the hour, so let's get beginning. Let's get started. How to bring out the best in your millennials, seven practices for greater engagement and productivity. And I'm David Lee. So I'm just going to quickly check to see what you're seeing. Let's advance this. Okay, so for those of you who haven't been to programs, just so you can attach a face to a name, and I am broadcasting from global headquarters, which actually looks nothing like that. It's my home office, and I let you know because I just want to let you know ahead of time that my blind rescue dog, Minnie, who takes her guard dog job seriously, might be barking if the UPS guy comes. Hopefully that won't be the case. Also, hopefully I won't be coughing a whole lot. I want to apologize ahead of time for that. I feel fine. It's just the aftermath, and it's just the cough that won't go away. So here's what I want to ask you to do is to, here goes the cough, excuse me, to treat this like a live program, not like the typical webinar. If you're a fan of conference call in real life, you know the scene that that comes from. So to take notes and to do the exercises. And if you have questions, excuse me, you've got that question box. And I'd sent all of you handouts ahead of time, and hopefully you've got those printed up. So let's get cracking on the seven practices. But first, I just want to give you just a quick context, and I don't want to turn this into a long, let's talk about me kind of thing. But one of the things that I've been so fascinated by over the years and a lot of my work focuses on is what's the difference between managers and employers that have really disinterested, disengaged workforces compared to employers like Southwest Airlines or Zappos that have passionate, we're all in this together employees, as well as lesser known companies. This is a fabulous company that does digital marketing analytics, Zoomf, and they just have a stellar culture where everybody is working as a team, including holding each other accountable and kindly, how can I help you get this project moving kind of ways. And so part of what I've been doing over the last 20 plus years is distilling out the differences that make the difference. And employers and managers who know how to bring out the best in people, with a special emphasis in the last few years on millennials, since that's oftentimes the biggest source of puzzlement for managers. And so in the in-person version, I shared a video. It's from the People Are Awesome series, People Working Really Fast at Work. And it's not quite the same to hear about it than to see it. But it's these video clips of people just being so passionate about their work and doing it at an elite level, including primarily just simple, seemingly non-intrinsically rewarding jobs, like this guy here is a window washer. And so here's what I want to ask you to do. To remember, I want to treat this as a we're in the same room kind of seminar. So one of the things that I did with this group is to ask them, after we saw the video, is what's the most important thing? Okay, I just want to see when you, okay, your manager does that allows and supports this kind of passionate work. So just pretend you saw the video of people being really into their work and doing a great job. And what does your manager not do? And because of that, your enthusiasm and passion is not squelched. So let's just do number one for now. So if you could type into the question box, what's one thing that your manager does that supports and encourages you to be passionate about your work? So please go ahead and put that in the question box, and I'll read a couple of them, and then we'll move on. And so as I'm waiting for responses, welcomes new ideas. All right, gives me FedEx time. Okay, great. What else? Okay, let's see what this says. They don't tell me to stop what I'm doing as it related to my passion. Fantastic. We'll do one more. Whoops. Okay. We've got that one. What's this one say? Okay. That one. Okay. We've got this. Shows trust in my decisions. Awesome. All right. So, okay, we'll do one more time. Allows me to pursue new ideas, research time with I specific result required. I'm not sure what that means, with no specific result. Shares appreciative comments from clients. Okay, fantastic. So this is an exercise I encourage you to use with your managers, and also if you're a manager, with your team. It's a great way to start the conversation about how I can bring out the best in you. And so one of the things that I do and working with managers, encourage them to start off easy, so to speak. And what I mean by that is ask their employees to talk about previous managers that either brought out the best in them or brought out the not so best in them. And what were those practices for both? Okay. So let's move on. And I want you to think about this as a homepage for a website. So let's say your company or organization's homepage doesn't have every bit of info jammed on that homepage. There's text, and then there are hyperlinks where they can read other stuff like about us, programs and services, etc. And so I want you to think of this as a homepage with hyperlinks for later. And I literally have a hyperlink for later that has resources actually from the conference I spoke at. I forgot to change that out to a more generic one. All kinds of articles. There's some also audio and video that build on this if you want to go deeper and share this with your managers. There's also lots of how-to material on having the conversation, which is really at the foundation of engaging your millennials and all employees. But just quick backdrop, so we're all on this proverbial same page. So there's some variation in what people consider as millennials, but the easiest way is just think about people born in the 80s or 90s. Now, excuse me, highly recommend Bruce Tolkien's work. I was just speaking at a conference in June where he also was speaking. He just has some outstanding research. And I remember him from back in the day when Gen X, if you're a Gen Xer, when you were the new and puzzling generation in the workforce, and that's when he first started doing his research. But he divides millennials into Gen Y and Gen Z because there have been cultural differences that impact the way they show up in the workplace. But because this whole generational difference thing and, you know, what about those millennials thing tends to spark some sort of black and white thinking and polarity in people, I want to sort of lay the groundwork before we get into the how-tos, because I think this piece here can be a real eye-opener and a game-changer once you appreciate it. So some generational different common sense to keep in mind that not all people in a generation are just alike, just like not all men are alike, all women are alike. If you know Myers-Briggs, not all ESTJs are alike, not all INFPs are alike. So have it as an understood when we talk about millennials that not every millennial has every characteristic. So just because you're in a particular generation doesn't mean you'll relate to every characteristic. And a lot of my work lately has been involved in, I started doing this about 10 years ago, but picked it up again recently because of the increase in interest in millennials, is interviewing millennials. And it was interesting, one of my interviews, a millennial said, well, I'm not really sure I'm a millennial because I don't really relate to a lot of the characteristics. And it's not about whether you relate to the characteristics, it's whether you fit in the demographics. And so you might find, just like I, as a boomer, have found that there are qualities of Gen X and millennials that I relate to more than baby boomer. So again, if you're trying to talk about millennials to millennials, especially to make sure they get it, that it doesn't mean they have every of the common characteristics that are ascribed to millennials. It's also super important to realize that generational differences are just one of the many factors that influence how a person thinks, acts, their work ethic, their communication, etc. And one of the things that I found in my interviews over and over again, and actually the research backs this up, is that parenting style has a huge impact regardless of the generation. And so some of the millennials I've interviewed had the same work ethic of, let's say, a baby boomer or a traditionalist, because they were raised by parents who had more of a appropriate old school style. And I say appropriate, not that children should be seen and not heard, or, spanking with a shovel, that sort of thing, but holding their kids accountable, making them work for their allowance, not spoiling them, etc. So one of the other differences, sometimes people get all hot under the collar and oppositional about this whole millennial thing by saying, well, they're no different than any other, youthful person. You were the same way when you were young. And there are obviously developmental differences between somebody in their 20s, let's say, and somebody in their 40s or 50s. And it's helpful to tease out those differences of youth from the cultural differences that have influenced millennials or Gen X or boomers, et cetera. And lastly, the goal is to foster understanding. It's not to label people and pigeonhole them and then relate to them according to the label. It's to have more empathy and compassion and savvy in terms of how to deal with them. So one of the things when I give this at conferences, I love sharing this, and especially asking the boomers in the audience who can relate to this. Young employees are demanding that they be given productive tasks to do from the first day of work, and that the people they work for notice and react to their performance. And I see all these knowing looks, and then I show surprise that you see what date this was published in. And so people were saying that about, again, it's that sort of youth thing. People were saying that about the younger generation for baby boomers. Now, how about this one? Tell me if you don't relate to this. Today's children now love luxury. They have bad manners, contempt for authority, and they show disrespect for elders and love chatter in place of exercise. You can probably think of that as being so true, except that's what Socrates, Mr. Smart Guy, said many, many years ago. And you might remember this movie, Bill and Ted's Excellent Adventure, the documentary of how they went back in time and actually met Socrates, or Socrates, as they called him. So the two competing views of millennials, and again, this is where I want to blast through the black and white thinking and get to the nuance here. The two views are either millennials are like this alien life form that are so different from everybody else. And then the other polar opposite are like, oh, millennials are no different. And there's the blend of the two. And a thing to keep in mind, if you tend to be in the they're no different than anybody else, is to keep in mind that you can't help but be influenced by the cultural milieu that you were born in. So those of you who are Gen X, the latchkey generation. So, whether it's somebody who grew up in the Depression, somebody who grew up in the wild Woodstock days, time when parents, their kids grew up having their parents getting laid off, and that whole social contract between employers and employees getting destroyed, and then in a much more attentive, children are the center of the family cultural norm of the last 20 years or so. It can't help but influence how young people perceive themselves in the world. But what hit me, and see, this is back. Whoops, I forgot to take my phone off the hook. Sorry about that. That hit me back in 2009 was that people were missing what I think of as the hidden gift of Gen Y employees. And that is that they're the canary in the coal mine. So this is the last, this is like the big, big idea, if you will, before we dive into the practices. And if you haven't done any coal mining as a child, or it's not part of your family history, that miners use canaries as their early warning sign. That was the early technology for poisonous gases in the mine. And so if the canary stopped singing, the miners would head for the top because they were more sensitive to the poisonous gases. And that's what I think of as millennials in the workplace. And so the big picture is millennials want what other generations want. But here's the thing. With millennials, you don't have to wonder if you're creating a work experience that attracts and retains talent. You don't have to wonder, like, what's up with how come we've got turnover here? Or, like a lot of employers do, labor under the illusion that they're doing all the right things and there's nothing else they can do to boost engagement or productivity. Because the thing with millennials, if they think they have a lousy employer or a lousy manager, they let you know. They quit. And so that's actually one of the huge hidden benefit of millennials. And if you're having millennial turnover, here's the deal. If you're having high millennial turnover, you're probably having low engagement with your other generations. I'm sure a number of people on this webinar are familiar with Gallup's research showing that 55% of employees are road warriors, retired on active duty. So these are the people that are just sort of like the walking dead. They show up to collect a paycheck, but there's no passion, enthusiasm in their work. And so ask yourself, would you rather have a workforce of 55% road warriors and a workforce of the walking dead and think that there's nothing else you can do to make it better, or have employees telling you, you know, this is a lousy place to work, telling you either verbally or by leaving? And so that's what I mean by the canary in the coal mine. And so that sets us up for the how-to part of this, because if you do these things that bring out the best in your millennials, it'll also bring out the best in your other employees. Okay, so let's dive in. Number one, dial up the relational component. And just real quickly as to the why, that if you think about this generation has had in general, much more attentive, much more involved parenting than previous generations. Now, there's a program that I've done at a bunch of conferences called Why Your Employees Are Just Not That Into You. And one of the mantras that I hope to embed in the consciousness of attendees is this one. If your employees are just not that into you, perhaps they don't experience you as being into them. And so part of that is that relational piece. Let me share something from this really fascinating LinkedIn post that, as you see, from a couple of years ago, it had over a million views. Why Millennials Keep Dumping You, an Open Letter to Management. I highly encourage you to share this post with all your managers. And so here's a excerpt from it. This job will quickly become nothing more than my rent payment. I'll start living for Friday. Oops, there's a shoot. I edited this from the other one, and it said, there's one part that I missed, which I apologize for. It said, if you treat me like a number, I'll start doing the same to you. So this job will quickly become nothing more than my rent payment. I'll start living for Friday and counting down the minutes until 5. After a few months of that, I'll probably have a drunken epiphany and realize I want more out of my life than this. And so notice this, that 2 out of the 5 top drivers of millennial engagement relate to the relational piece of the employee experience. So feeling valued and being treated like a person and not a number. And here's one of the challenges I find. And if you're not familiar with the DISC profile, I highly recommend that you have your managers get DISC profile training. It really helps them dial up their ability to bring out the best in different styles of personalities. It's also really helpful for your customer-facing employees, customer service, tech support, etc. Well, without getting into the DISC profile, you see on the left it says task-oriented. So people who are high D and high C, so driver and conscientious. People who are high in task orientation, and these are oftentimes the ones who get promoted to management, oftentimes forget the relational part of managing. And what I mean by relational, I don't mean like, oh, let's be BFFs. It means, in part, the basic courtesies, civilities, and pleasantries that we hopefully do in our personal lives that keep, quote, the fabric of society from unraveling. So let me give you an example of this. So, hi, Chris, hope all is well with you. Hey, just wanted to check to see if you got the email I sent last week with my thoughts on what to cover in the presentation. And if so, if you feel like it hits the mark. If you could let me know as soon as possible, that would be great, as I want to allot enough time for preparation so it's as helpful as possible to your group. Thanks and best regards. So this is actually a made-up email, but I've had plenty like this. So notice, pretend I'm an employee in this situation, that the employee wants to make sure that their boss is getting this thing that they sent them so the employee can do the best possible work. And so they're signaling, I care about doing a great job, and I want to make sure that you got it because I haven't heard back from you. And if I don't hear back from you in a timely way, I can't do the kind of job that I want to do. Chris responds, yes, I did. Looks fine. So that's a great example. I'm sure you've had these kinds of emails, and maybe you've delivered some of these emails. So that's a great example of Chris being very transactional with no indication that, oops, sorry, I didn't confirm receipt of that. No indication, I appreciate your follow-up and your diligence, just this transactional and personal way of relating. And that, when managers interact that way, it sucks the life out of especially the relationally oriented employees. So relational means acknowledging you're a human being, not a robot, an app, or a machine whose only value is the output you deliver. And then when you dial it up to a higher level of being relational, it's showing interest in the person as a person and showing you care about that person's as an individual with a life. So not you have to sacrifice your personal life in order to do your job, but how can we work together to help you do your job? Because, you know, we pay you to do a job here. That's why you're hired, and you're a human being worthy of value and respect. And so how can we work together to make this a win-win? So here's an example of a rock star manager and actually leader, JT O'Donnell, who founded workitdaily.com, which I highly recommend. It's just an outstanding site for growing your career. And two of her employees attended a seminar of mine, and they were both really impressive, and it was clear they really liked their employer, so I interviewed them. And here's just one example. When I asked them, what does JT do that makes you like so psyched to go to work and inspired to do your best? And one of the comments was this. She pays attention to what I say and remembers where we left off. It's remembering that last conversation. And so one of her team members, one of her associates, talked about recently that she and her boyfriend had bought a house and they're remodeling. And this employee had shared about, you know, they just started the remodeling process, let's say. And later on in the week or the next week, JT asked her, hey, how's the project going? And then she checks in every now and then. And you think about that. It's not rocket science. But it's that little bit of mindfulness and thoughtfulness and showing interest in people as a person. So here's what I want to ask you to do. We could do a whole lot more. And I've got a number of articles on the relationship or the relational piece. But right now, I just want to ask you to go to the last page of your handouts and jot down what's something that you will do to practice being more relational. So maybe it's being a better listener. Maybe it's having a few more niceties in your email. What will you do? So I'm going to give you 1 minute, and if you answer really quickly, if you can go ahead and put your answer after you do it in your worksheet in your in the question box. Awesome. Look for ways to add more praise. Fantastic. That is, thanks, Sharon. That is one of the simplest, most powerful ways, especially of millennials, to boost engagement. Okay. So the question about the handouts, there should be some place on your dashboard that allows you to download it. If not, just email me afterwards. Public recognition of accomplishment. We'll talk some more about that. Fantastic. Okay, we'll do one more. Okay, I would like to work on remembering personal details. Fantastic. Yes, that's a tough one for me too. Okay. So let's move on here. Number two. Whoops. I just want to make sure that you're seeing what I'm seeing. Communicate the why. This is my little adaptation to Nietzsche's famous quote, employees can deal with almost any what if they understand and believe in the why. So what's the why? And I will do this what's the why on a follow-up sheet. Okay. So number one, why you exist, not you as a person exists, but why your organization exists. So what does that mean? It means telling stories of the good work that your organization does. It's explaining the why behind changes. That's one of the most important areas that a lot of leadership teams drop the ball, is they don't do a good enough reason, or do enough a good enough job explaining the reasoning behind changes. And this is one of those. If employees understand the reasoning behind the change, even if they're not thrilled with the change, it's like, okay, this is a drag, but I get it. They're way more able to handle it and not resistant to it. Why this project is important, excuse me, and this is really important with millennials who were, in general, raised in the ethos of make a difference in the world, make an impact on the world. So showing why this is important is really important. And this is also really important, and it'll tie into another point I'm going to make in a minute, which is why their job exists. Here's why your job exists. Here's the value your job provides. And here are the behaviors that when you engage in, provide the most value. And when you don't engage in them, you're not providing a whole lot of value. This is also something that's not just important with millennials, but also for a particular personality style. Those of you, excuse me, who know DISC know that C's, the conscientious personality, really needs to know the rationale in order for them to buy in. The other part, and this will link us to something that's coming up shortly, the why of your feedback. So why is it important to come in on time? Why is it important to be not just answering the caller's question, but to be thinking about why, or to be thinking about what other problems might this problem they're calling about be linked to, and how might I solve those problems before they crop up so they don't have to make a return call. Okay, so if you can go back to your back page, and which one of these whys do you want to put on your action step to get better at? So to please go ahead and do that. And if you're like super speedy quick, you can type in what you came up with in the questions. We'll do 20 more seconds. Okay, let's see. The Why of Expectations. Awesome. Fantastic. Put their duties in a bigger... Oh, big one, Laura. Bing, 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 bing. Huge. That is one of the most important things to do, not just in guiding behavior and showing this is why these behaviors are so important. It's also one of the best ways of boosting resilience during difficult times. So big flashing, lights and siren for that one. Okay. Number three, it's all about the conversation. One of my little mantras, every better result you want requires a better conversation. So whether it's a performance issue or like, why aren't employees going the extra mile? Or what can we do to make this a more attractive place for millennials? The answers are in the people. Just like world-class customer service companies know that the answer, by and large, to how to delight your customers are in your customers. So because of time considerations, I'm just going to ask you to go to page 4 and jot down one result that you would like to see more of from your team. And I encourage you later. So if we were doing this in a longer version, we would brainstorm questions you could ask that could help you find out how you can help them deliver that result. But for now, just write down one result, and hopefully doing that will apply. It's called the Zeigarnik effect. Boy, pulling that blast from the past. That if you start something, your brain is sort of like bothers you to finish it because it wants closure. So if you start this exercise, you're more likely to finish it. Okay. Solving problems or making recommendations on their own versus giving them the answers. Fantastic. Okay, I'm just going to say one quick thing and then I'll move on. So that's also, maybe that's, so action step will be to have those conversations, or actually any conversation in your action step that you know you need to have to get a better result. So let's go to number 4, and I'm going to link into that solving problems or making recommendations on their own versus giving them the answers. While one of the most important things for managers to do in general is to coach how to be a great employee coach, it's even more important with millennials because of the differences in professionalism. And I actually interviewed one of the researchers of this. They did an annual professionalism survey where they interview HR professionals and hiring managers. And you just see the top stat here where a percentage of interviewees feeling less than half of the new employees exhibit professionalism in their first year, to see how it's increased almost, basically 10% from 2009 to 2013. So basically, half of employees coming newly into the workforce are seen as not being professional. And so one of the things that's really important is manager as, this is what equals being a professional. And so in that resource page I put together, I've got a bunch of articles on how to have that conversation. Obviously, if you want on-site training on that, I would be thrilled to hear from you to help you do that. But it's not just the professionalism piece, managers and how to be a great employee coach. It's for all employees. And this actually gets back to Laura, your point about, actually it's more the put the question, put the behaviors in a bigger context, and then I'll link to the solving problems. So actually, let me do the solving problems first. So one of the conversations on the how to be a great employee coach that managers need to have, and what I've noticed over the years is most managers have a really hard time doing, is having line of sight conversations that are what I call training video specific. So for instance, so let me give you two examples. So let's say the goal of having employees solve problems versus always coming to their manager to solve the problem. And that's one of the most frequent laments that I get from managers. So one of the conversations in the how to be a great employee coaching conversation would be, one of the most important attributes or practices of somebody on this team, or actually an employee in this company, is being a proactive problem solver. And what I mean by that is coming up with options and solutions to solve a problem on your own versus coming to the supervisor, in this case, me. Now, that being said, I know obviously there will be some problems that you won't be able to solve. But because that practice, that behavior is so important, I want you to know that when you come to me and ask me to solve a problem for you, I will be asking you what you've tried. And also, for some of these situations, I'll ask you for your thought process. And if you say, I didn't try anything, then I'm either going to send you back to try some things, or we'll do a little coaching to get you started in the thought process. And if you did come up with things, and we talk about why it worked or why it didn't work, and I will share with you my thought processes, and some of the times I will give you some things to think about and come up, because my goal is for you to come up with the answer yourself. Now, that's sort of preparing them for the situation. Now, the customer service training the training video description is where you give examples of the behavior in action. So describing a situation where, let's say, you did some problem solving on your own versus going to your boss for the answer, or some other employee who's great at that. So it's like you're narrating a training video. So let's say this, six ways to get an angry customer to back down, okay? So you would be, if you're describing the behaviors that you're looking for, it's almost like you're narrating a training video. They can't see the video and you're describing what it looks and sounds like. So let me go back to, I'm going to do previous here, Ritz-Carlton, because they are just the best of the best at using examples to illustrate this is how to be a great employee. And so what they do in their team meetings every day, every shift has a huddle. And three, at least when I did a program years ago with their head of leadership, Diana Orrick, who now has moved on, and at least back then, she told me three out of the five huddles they had, they would share a wow story of employee providing wow customer service. And I'll just give you one of my favorite wow stories, just because it's so awesome. And so one of the wow stories, so we did this program on how to use storytelling and new hire orientation and coaching, employer branding, etc. FYI, most employers could use a huge upgrade in the use of storytelling in all aspects of talent management. But in this seminar that we did, one of the stories that Diana shared was how this little girl at one of their properties lost her tooth. So she was at the age where the primary teeth came out. And she freaks out because it's like, oh man, we're away from home and the tooth fairy can't find me and, no tooth fairy swag. So she's really upset. So her parents calm her down and they go back inside from the pool area, get changed, go out on the town and do whatever touristy kind of thing they were doing. And then when they come back, they walk into the hotel and there in the lobby is the tooth fairy. And it was so cute because the little girl knew immediately who the tooth fairy was for. And she runs up and gives the tooth fairy a big hug. And it's a beautiful thing. And the tooth fairy gives her this, awesome Ritz-Carlton tooth fairy swag bag. Now, in the seminar that we did, Diana used that as an example of creating a wow experience that builds your company's brand. But it's also a great example of using a story as like a training video to employees about this is what awesome looks like. This is what world-class customer service looks like. So one of the things, that you want your managers to do is get really good at using concrete examples and sharing stories so they provide a crystal clear movie of what desired behaviors look and sound like. Okay, so if you can go on over to that back page, and what's something that you'll do to be a more effective, how to be a great employee coach? So we're going to do 20 seconds for this one. Okay. And one last thing, true confession, I noticed I put that slide when I was reconfiguring the slides from the conference, I put that slide out of order. So my bad. One of the other aspects of being, and this is super important for your millennials, is having constructive feedback or just having feedback being part of everyday life. And this is part of understanding the psychology and sociology of millennials and why managers can't be doing old school, only give negative feedback, old school, only give feedback once a year at the performance review. Because you think about, in general, this generation has gotten constant coaching, constant feedback, oftentimes micromanaging from their parents and adults in their life. And to go from that constant feedback loop to just this, not black hole, but empty space of no feedback is really disorienting and disheartening. And that's something I've gotten over and over from the millennials I've interviewed about, we want feedback and the negative feedback too. And this article that's on your resource page, it's based on two very different contexts, as you can see. I'll just speak to the millennial managing millennials. This is actually, a millennial manager from UNH that I interviewed a couple years ago, and I'm actually doing a follow-up interview next week because the things that she was saying in the public seminar I gave were so awesome. I wanted to get more intel on what she and her fellow supervisors and managers did to create such a accountable, high-performing workforce among primarily college student, teenage and early 20 library workers. And one of the things that she said, and you'll read it in the article, is how they made it clear from day one that feedback is just what we do here. And it's part of everyday life. And because of that, isn't just negative feedback, it's positive feedback. Okay, let's move on to number 5. the desire for intellectual stimulation, growth, and professional development, how to satisfy and support these powerful drivers of employee engagement. So I've got this little baby here, little toddler, because anybody who has a toddler or baby or has an adult grown-up child who was once one, or you've seen little babies or toddlers, you know that you don't have to bribe a little kid to learn to walk. You're not like, mom and dad don't stand back 10 feet with a muffin or a cookie and say like, come here, come here. Like, no, that desire to learn, to solve problems, to master their environment, that is hardwired into the human nervous system. And what that means is it's intrinsically motivating, which means that opportunities to solve problems, to learn stuff, to figure things out is intrinsically rewarding. Another way of saying it is when employees get a chance to use their brains at work, when they get a chance to learn new things, when they get a chance to be on the job figuring out how to make a process better or serve a customer better, when they get the opportunity to do that, it boosts their dopamine level. And I know some of you on this webinar know that dopamine is like the ultimate secret sauce of being happy and pumped up and enthusiastic. It's also when people get addicted, it's because whatever drug or activity they're involved in boosts their dopamine levels. So if you want a dopamine-rich culture, i.e. engaged, happy, enthusiastic employees, give them plenty of opportunity to grow now and learn and solve problems. And when I say learn, I'm not saying send them to seminars, although that's important, as you see the stat in your handout, how millennials place a super high value on professional development, but I mean being more creative on the job. So learning isn't just like once a quarter or once a year, it's an everyday thing. So let me give you a quick example. So one of the things when I was a training manager at a call center for an insurance company, one of the things that we would do is have employees be on the lookout for language patterns, word choice, etc., that seem to be really effective in calming down angry customers, or notice how they handled a particular type of customer, and then we would document it and share it with all the other call center reps. So that's a simple example of embedding learning in the workplace. You might be familiar with Dr. Teresa Mabile's work that she published in Harvard Business Review and then in this popular book. And what she found was the number one driver of employee engagement of employees that did knowledge work, so any kind of work that required thought and discernment and making differences, the number one source of engagement was progress toward their goals. And if you look at Gallup's Q12, three of the 12 drivers of engagement are related to professional development. And so making sure that you're providing professional development opportunities for employees, all your employees, but especially millennials, is so important. So please keep in mind that it's not just sending to seminars, it's having them have opportunities to grow on the job, have to solve problems. In fact, my team, when I was the training manager, said one of the things that they liked about me compared to their other managers was that I asked them about what skills they wanted to develop, and I looked for opportunities on the job for them to do those things where, let's say, it would be more, I would typically do those because of my level, I would let them do those. And they really appreciate that. So I'm aware of the time. Officially, I said till 10 of. I'm just going to keep going. If you need to bail out, no harm, no foul. You can watch the end of the recording. But just to jot down in your worksheet, what's one thing that you're going to do to involve employees more in problem solving, give them opportunities to bring their brains to work, grow professionally? Okay. So number six, value, support, and focus, the enthusiasm, confidence, and optimism of youth. Don't crush it. We've always done it this way. This is one of the things I heard over and over from millennials that really made them start thinking about getting a job elsewhere. Conversely, the ones that were most psyched about where they worked, they talked about how their manager encourage them to use their creativity, encourage them to use their enthusiasm. Let me tell you a super short story. I actually wrote an article about this that I'm going to change and republish. I was doing a coaching session with a senior level leader who was getting ready to do a performance review with one of her hard-charging millennial employees. And I actually knew this young man. He had attended, I'd done a series of trainings for all their supervisors, managers, and leaders. And he stood out in the group as the most enthusiastic, the most eager to learn. Like, he's the one who knew about the books I brought up where everybody else didn't. And so he was like a dream employee. The only problem, and this is part of the aspect of youthful confidence and part of being a great manager and here's how to be a great employee coach as a manager, that he also overestimated his mastery of his position and wanted to move on to another position because his goal was to be the CEO, and he made that very clear. And so his manager was kind of rolling her eyes with me about him and saying, like, oh man, he's always talking about being the CEO and he thinks he's mastered the position. And you really have to be in this position for about 3 years to face all the different situations that you would face to get good at it. And I've got to tell him to like settle down, calm down. I mean, she's really had that kind of attitude. And so I really tried to impress upon her, be thankful, you know, of his enthusiasm. You know, you need to be really careful about how not to crush that. And so that's a skill that oftentimes old school managers don't have. And it's a great way to drive your millennials out the door. And so what's the next step? So if you zoom back over to your handout, what's the next step that you will take? And one simple one, this is a really cool thing that I heard from one of my recent millennials I interviewed, and it made me think of a story from 7 or 8 years ago. But I'll just tell you the brief version. She said, you know, one of the things that I really like about my manager is she lets me take things that I'm really passionate about that aren't necessarily part of my job description and bring those to work. And one of the things that I really loved doing in my previous job is bringing employees together for like social activities, both at work and after work. And it just really boosted morale and you know, that sort of esprit de corps. And even though that's not part of what I do here, my boss was like totally cool with me doing that. And it's fun because I love doing that. So one of the things also, if you think about millennials, is they tend to blur work and play. And so finding ways they can bring more of their personality and their avocation into the workplace. So last but not least, waiting for it to show up on your screen, there it goes, is the customized employee experience. The future is now. Fascinating research by the Hay Group showing that both in the customer experience and the employee experience, individualization is going to be one of the six mega trends. And it's already happening now. And I think of it as the Starbuckification of society. If you're a boomer, you remember like the only coffee you had was that horrible, it'd been on the like Bunsen burner thing, whatever that's called, for hours, and it's just nasty. And now, you know, you can have every variation of the song. Also with iTunes versus you had to buy an album and suffer through all the lousy songs to get to the one that you bought the damn album for. And so employees, especially millennials, are used to a tailored experience. So what does that mean? What it means is that you need to have, your managers need to have, you remember this from Jerry Maguire, that rather embarrassing scene, the non-embarrassing version of that help me help you scene. And what the non-embarrassing version is managers having the help me help you help us conversation. That's how you get to not just customizing the employee experience, but helping managers know how to bring out the best in each employee. And in that resource page, I've got articles, a bunch of different articles on the different types of conversations to have. And again, if you want something in-house on that, just let me know after. Here's one version that in one of the articles I wrote. It's a stop, start, and more of. So as a manager, to say, what's the one thing that if I started doing would make the biggest difference in your being psyched about being here and being able to perform at your best? What's the one thing that if I stopped doing would make the biggest difference? And just FYI, oftentimes the one thing stopped that I get is micromanaging. What's one thing I already do that you would recommend I do more of? So maybe it's the, I love it when you give positive feedback, but it only happens once a year. It'd be great if it happened, you know, more often than that. So that's the stop, start, and more of conversation. Last but not least, and then we'll wind up, is what I call the, you know, I went to that seminar conversation. And one of the things I recommend to managers, because sometimes managers feel awkward about like trying out new and improved managerial behaviors, or like I'm suddenly asking them these questions that seem kind of strange. One of the simple ways, like icebreakers to kind of ease into the conversation, is just to say, you know, I went to that seminar on managing, supervising employees, or, hey, I just attended this webinar on bringing out the best in millennials. And one of the things that they talked about was blah, blah, blah. You know, what's your take on that? What can we do here to make it more of a, you'll feel connected with the big picture? Or what can I do to be more of a mentor and coach than just like giving you your marching orders? So last but not least, what action will you take? And one of the things I encourage you to do, just action to take, is read some of those, how to customize the employee experience. I also recommend there's some more sort of like conceptual thought leadership articles on the resource page, which addresses the why employees are just not that into you. Why, after literally billions of dollars being spent in America alone on employee engagement is still low. It basically hasn't budged in the last 15 years. And so if you're trying to spread the word with your fellow managers to help them, you know, get on board to be doing some of these things, some of those articles can be your next step. So we've got a bunch of next steps. Hopefully you filled them out to the end result of a more productive millennials, more engaged millennials, higher quality work, behaviors more in line with your company culture, and also being more talent magnet status. And remember, part of the reason why we did that big idea about the millennials, the canary in the coal mine, is that if you do these things, it doesn't just show up in your millennials, it shows up in all your employees. So there's, obviously you know how to reach me, but I threw this in for those watching the video. Information how to contact me, and I've got some support material I will finish up with. Any closing questions before we sign out here? I'm just get rid of these that were asked. Any closing questions? And obviously, you know, you can follow up with any kind of questions through email or give me a buzz, and glad to dive in deeper or answer specific ways of tailoring what we talked about here. So no questions that I see. So thanks for joining. And one thing I would really appreciate if you would do for me is if you would just shoot me out an email to give me feedback, anything that was either especially helpful or could have been done better. And so an FYI, you're doing that also is good practice in terms of being more relational in the workplace. One of the things that really saddens me in so many workplaces in terms of how impersonal and transactional is that oftentimes people will interact with others, whether it's through email or through phone, only when they want something from that other person. But if it's something that's beneficial to the other person, like giving them feedback or expressing appreciation, they don't have time for that. Oh my God, I sent the speaker note one. Yikes. Thanks for the heads up. How embarrassing. Thanks, Lisa. I'll send out the, I will send out the non-speaker version. Man, gotta love it. So thank you. So I will send out the speaker version so you have a nice clean version of that. So how embarrassing. So again, please send me some feedback. Really appreciate that. This is version 2.0 and always looking to tweak and improve for version 3.0. And so I'm actually thinking of doing this as an in-house program for employers. So anyway, thanks so much for attending, and hope to see you in the future. Take care. Bye.